Hello, check.
Hello. It's fine. Okay. Sorry, one sec. Thanks, sorry. My notes are over here.
Yeah. Do you want a coffee as well before you?
I'm good, I think. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Should be fine.
Some hot water or something?
Discussion. Actually, regular water would be fine. Yeah. That's the connection.
Yeah, I see.
What a small world.
Yeah. So she was very annoyed with me. She's like, why are you stealing all my speakers? Because I think you're speaking tomorrow as well at NCBS.
Well,
right?
No, NCBS was yesterday.
Oh, yeah.
Tomorrow is in Rangasthala. But Champaka was the first place I went to speak.
Right.
So there should be no complaints from Champaka at least.
Yeah.
No,
I think we're
yeah, no,
just
I,
happy to have
Sorry? Yeah, sure. Sure, yeah. There's not a problem.
So there's
not
a problem.
Yeah. Sure, sure, yeah.
Sit here.
You should like go away from the screen, sir.
Okay, hi, good afternoon, everyone. Thanks so much for coming. Welcome to Obvious. I'm Padmini, I'm head of communications here. We just wanted to tell you that there are just a few housekeeping rules to observe. The bathrooms are to your left. And there's coffee and tea and water. Please help yourself during the course of the conversation. We have a code of conduct that will be enforced during the event in case you want to take a look at it. It's on our playbook, which is available at the link on top. If you need anything, do just come and talk to me. Otherwise, enjoy the event. And I think we're going to focus. Gautam's going to talk maybe a little less than he anticipated he will, because we think that we need more time for discussion and questions and answers. So that's probably going to be the way that we're going to
take it.
So yeah, I'll just hand over to Kiran, who is from HasGeek, hosting this event. Thanks very much.
Yeah. So I'm actually hosting this event on behalf of the community. We are a group of people from technical and legal backgrounds who have been working on decoding how technology intersects with the law. And Gautam's been part of the group for a couple of years now, at least.
Yeah.
And Gautam's been a huge source of understanding of how to interpret the law for all those of us coming from a technical background. And so that's something I want to understand, audience. How many of you are from a technical background? Okay. And how many from a legal background? Okay. And how other backgrounds? Yeah. So there's design, there's marketing in the back over there. I'm sure there's a huge diversity of it. Yeah. Music. Okay. So part of what we're going through in our modern society is used to think of the law as being somewhat remote while we went about our day-to-day lives. And the law was just something to be afraid of because you would get caught crossing the road when you're not supposed to cross and then you pay a fine or something trivial like that. And over the last few years, at least for us in the tech community, realize that our work intersects law a lot more than we are comfortable with, and a lot more that we have awareness of. And therefore, the software that we write has consequences for human rights that we did not see coming, and we do not know how to think about at all. So part of what the current community has been trying to do over the last couple of years is bring that awareness into mainstream society. And obviously, we don't do this by saying, here is something to read, but we try to do this by saying, go where people are already reading, which is mainstream publications. So if a journalist is writing about software problems and how they're affecting citizens, we try to help them understand what is this software in the first place and how is it affecting people in ways that may not yet be manifesting as problems. So that's one side of it. And Gautam, obviously, a constitutional scholar, has been helping us understand how to think about the law in the first place. And the books, I think, are fantastic reading. This is his second book. He's got another one on free speech. Both of them are really worth reading. I think Gautam is an incredibly good writer. He also has a blog on Indian constitutional law and philosophy. It's a blog that is both extremely readable and is also well-read, in that you will find Supreme Court justices reading the blog to understand how their own verdicts are making sense outside of their own courts. Okay. So Gautam, over to you.
Yeah, thanks. So first of all, thank you to HasGeek for inviting me, and thank you to Obvious for this beautiful space. It feels very nice to be here. I should begin by also clarifying how I come to this whole issue. And so around 2015-16, I was approached to help out with the Aadhaar litigation, the constitutional challenge to Aadhaar that was then pending in the Supreme Court. And over the next 3 years, I was heavily involved in research, in some drafting, in briefing lawyers to argue the case and so on. And that was when I began to understand the interface between technology and the law, and more specifically the Constitution and human rights. So that's how I came to all of this. And I should also therefore clarify that I am a lawyer and my background is legal. I'm not a technologist, and so obviously my expertise is not in that domain. And so I think what at least what I will try to put across through the course of this discussion is to maybe bring to light some of the constitutional principles that I found coming up again and again in cases like Aadhaar and in other similar cases, and how I as a lawyer found the interface between technology and human rights to be. And perhaps that might give some of you ideas about how these principles, these values might be relevant in your work. And we could, of course, take that forward in the discussion. So I want to begin with a small anecdote that I came across very recently, although the broader context of that is something I've been reading about for a while now. And this story begins in Chile in 1968. Chile 1968 is when a man called Salvador Allende, who used to be a doctor working in rural areas, bringing medical services to poor people, finds himself the president of Chile at the head of the Socialist Party, and he's won the election. And this is the second attempt. He lost the first time. The second time, he is successful. And one of Allende's first real goals is to mitigate the severe imbalance in the control of resources in Chile, because over the course of history, a few private players had basically captured ownership over most of the important natural resources in Chile. So Allende begins with nationalizing some of the important natural resources. But unlike the top-down socialist model that we've come to associate with nationalization, he doesn't stop there, and he doesn't think that that is what this project is about. Because what he's really keen to do and to bring, based on his experiences working as a doctor in rural areas, is to bring a genuine democratic participation in decisions about how resources are to be used, how factories should work, and so his idea of management is decentralized, and it envisions people having significant decision-making control over these kinds of activities, what we now know as the idea of industrial democracy. So, and the other unique thing about Allende is that he is very, very curious about technology. And so he combines these two interests, and he wants to use technology to implement his idea of a certain democratic decentralization of management and control. To do that, Allende's advisors approach an eccentric Englishman called Stafford Beer, who has been engaged in all kinds of ideas and writing about how tech can be used in management, and there's a theory called informational cybernetics that he pioneers in many books. And so they approach Stafford Beer, and Stafford Beer flies to Chile to advise Allende on how to develop this idea. And that becomes something called Project CyberSyn, and that is a photograph of the control room of Project CyberSyn back, and this is built in 1970, so much before the real explosion of tech and its omnipresence. So they build Project CyberSyn, and the way it's supposed to work is that you have a number of telex machines that connect individual factories to this control room, and you have inputs coming in from these factories that are on a regular basis about production data, figures, what's happening there. And then these are fed into economic models that give you information about what that means. And then decision makers sitting here have access to all these screens, and then they can take calls on whether something is going well or going badly, and so on. An interesting application of this was when Allende is severely disliked by the outgoing establishment. And so to attempt to bring down his government, they organize a strike of truck drivers to attempt to prevent resources from being transported across the country and therefore create a shortage. So Allende and his advisors use Project CyberSyn to understand where to bring the resources to at what times. And with the help of a small number of trucks, 200 trucks, they're able to break the 40,000 trucks that are part of the strike by strategically going to where resources are most needed. So that's one application this is put to. Now, the ending is not a happy one. So Allende is overthrown in a military coup in 1973, and General Pinochet takes power. And the first thing he does is to destroy Project Cybersyn. So that it ends without it ever actually being taken forward and genuinely becoming a model or a project. And Stafford Beer then also has to flee. And he has survivor's guilt for the rest of his life and doesn't really do anything after that. That's how the story ends. But the really interesting anecdote I want to put out, could we have the next photo, please? Is that, yeah. So when this is a photograph, an illustration from Stafford Beer's book, where he's basically connecting how the firm works and how the human body works. And he's selling the project to INA using these diagrams. And so he's basically comparing the control room that you saw a few minutes ago to the brain and how the brain directs the intelligence inputs of the body and directs various movements in the body. And so he's selling it to INA using this illustration. And he's about to say that, look, this is how it's all going to work. And that brain there in that illustration, that's you. That's what he's going to tell him. Before he can say that, Allende leans back in his chair, smiles, looks at the brain and says, that's the people. And that, for Stafford Beer, is a moment of conversion, where a number of assumptions that he had held all his life about management, about control, about how the firm should work, in one line, in one sentence, in one illustration, are completely overturned. And later in life, when he's being interviewed about this project, he recalls that moment as being one of the most important moments of his life, where he understood exactly what INA's project was about. And this whole idea of if you think of the brain as being one person in control, the tech that you're going to then use will be utilized in certain ways, certain assumptions. If you think of the brain as not being the president or the leader, but being the democracy, the demos, the people, you think of it very differently, and its use becomes very different. And in these small illustrations and in these small words, the entire idea changes. So that's the anecdote, I think, that at least has stuck with me since I came across it a few days ago. And it for me, it helped to clarify what was so unique and different about the project. And if you're, of course, interested, there are a lot of articles and a lot of scholarship on what this whole thing was about and where it might have gone had it not been terminated early by a military coup. And that's kind of the framework within which I want to have this discussion that we often think of tech as being something neutral, external to the world, and its effects as being divorced from it. But often the effects come in the design itself and in the ideas that animate why we are doing what we are doing. So I want to start by the two quotes that I've come across and I came across during the course of research for my book, the last chapter of which deals with some of these ideas. The first quote I came across was in a piece in Factor Daily, an interview with the CEO of a company called Face Tagger. I don't know if that company is still around and if it's going. So the CEO was talking about the uses of Face Tagger, and he says, and I'll quote, imagine a guy walking on the road at 2 a.m. who is looking suspicious. Police patrol can take the suspect's photograph with our app and within a second receive details of his crime history. This was in the context of the Chennai police using the app in a marketplace before a festival was going to happen. And the CEO obviously thought that this was a very useful thing to check crime and to ensure law and order in the streets and so on. That's the first quote, and I'll come back to that. The second quote is something that Shyam Diwan, the leading lawyer for the petitioners in the Aadhaar case, said during the course of oral arguments in court. I was a few feet from him and I heard him say it, and it was quite a powerful moment. So when talking about Aadhaar and how Aadhaar resets the relationship between the individual and the state, Shyam Diwan said that the Constitution is not a charter of servitude. Those were his lines. And I'd like to, at the end of this discussion, draw the link between these two quotes, which may not immediately seem obvious, but I think that there is a fundamental and important link. But I'll begin by unpacking what Shyam Diwan said in a little more detail. So when he said that the Constitution is not a charter of servitude, what he meant was that the Constitution as an idea, as a document, as a vision, is fundamentally about power. It talks about the existing relations of power that exist in society, and it provides various pathways, various signposts, various methods to alter some of those relations of power. That comes across in various specific provisions which we could talk about. It comes across most vividly in the three words that you find in the preamble, which is now becoming quite popular. It's being read out, you know, in various protest gatherings. The three words that originally come from the French Revolution: liberty, equality, fraternity. In a very basic way, the idea of liberty is to increase freedom by constraining state power. The state, as we have found out in vivid terms recently, is a very, very powerful institution, and it can do a lot to all of us. So the idea of liberty, as enshrined in various constitutional provisions like the freedom of speech, the right to life, the right to personal liberty, the right to conscience, and so on, seeks to create a zone of freedom by putting limitations on the kinds of power the state can exercise upon you and in the ways in which it can do so and when it can't do so. The second idea, of course, is equality. And equality is also about power. So if you think about the long-lasting debate about reservations, good, bad, should we have them, should we not have them, it is fundamentally a question about how, over the last few centuries, relations of power have put certain kinds of barriers between people and access to very basic goods like education, public posts, and so on. And the vision of substantive equality that the Constitution subscribes to attempts to break those kinds of power relations by ensuring that that access is now provided through even proactive and affirmative means, like, for example, reservations and other ideas that we could talk about. And the third idea is fraternity. In very basic terms, the relations between individuals without the state playing any part. And that idea comes from a unique Indian history where the state, despite being very powerful, was never the only or the sole center of power. There were always social institutions, cultural institutions that exercised as great and as severe a kind of domination and power over individuals. Caste, of course, is the most vivid example of that. And it's interesting that Ambedkar, one of the chief drafting people of the Constitution, one of his foremost political movements was for access to water from village drinking wells, because Dalits weren't allowed to use the same well as upper castes were. And Ambedkar framed this movement as about being the right to access public space. And that found its way into the Constitution through provisions like Article 15, Clause 2, that prohibits discrimination between private persons in access to shops, hotels, restaurants, other public spaces on grounds of caste, gender, and so on. So you have these three ideas: liberty, equality, and fraternity, each of which are concerned with the different kinds of power relations that exist in society. And the idea of the Constitution is to interrogate them, to undermine them, and to create a new kind of equation where democracy, which is the equalization of these relations, comes not just in the equation between the individual and the state, but also in private relations involving private persons, because the kinds of power that operate there are as serious as exist when the state is involved. So for many years after the Constitution, this entire idea of power revolved around access to physical spaces, to physical goods, reservations being the one example, surveillance of a very basic kind, watching your house and so on, that was often an issue, sedition, all these ideas, they were set in the actual physical world. Over the last few years, what's happened is that the introduction of tech into this space, and therefore the connection between tech and the Constitution is that tech intervenes into these relations of power, and it could actually entrench some of them, perpetuate some of them, but also continue with the constitutional vision of undermining them, of democratizing them. So to understand how, let's come back to the face tagger quote, right? So just to reread the quote, imagine a guy walking on the road at 2 a.m. who is looking suspicious. A police patrol can take the suspect's photograph with our app and within a second receive details of his crime history. I want to focus on four phrases here. The first is the phrase looking suspicious. If you think about it, You think about 2 a.m. at night walking down the street. Who is it that looks suspicious and to whom? In this case, obviously, this interview is given to a Factor Daily. The people who read it are people like you and me. So who is it to us who looks suspicious? Now, if it's one of us, dressed like one of us, walking down, say, Church Street after a late night, that person wouldn't look suspicious to us. They would look, you know, what we think of as normal. And so they would to the police as well, also the addressees of this interview. The people who look suspicious are people who don't look like us normally, who are not dressed like us, whom we think as perhaps being from a socioeconomic background that is not as elite as us, and we think of them as perhaps being on the way to commit a crime or there for purposes that are not particularly healthy or good. And I'm recalling this incident just from yesterday, that there was that sting that India Today did about those attacks in JNU. And one of the people whom they've interviewed said that he was, you know, going with his stick and he saw a person with a beard who looked Kashmiri, and so he went and beat him up. Right? So you can see how the very term looking suspicious is not a neutral term. It's all about who is doing the looking, the watching, and what looks suspicious to them, and what they're in a position to do about that. And in this case, obviously, it's the police who will, if they think someone looks suspicious, can take that photograph and upload that into the database. Right? So that's one thing. Second is the police patrol. Now, in which neighborhoods do you find police patrols? Where does the police go and patrol? These are questions of political geography. And if you do a study in any big city, you'll find that certain neighborhoods and certain areas receive far greater police scrutiny than others do. And these are along the lines of income, along the lines of class, and often along the lines of religion. Srinivas Kodli, who I'm sure you all know, is not here right now, has done a lot of research in Hyderabad and shown how in Muslim neighborhoods, police have these cordon searches where they just randomly go in and ask people to give their Aadhaar details. So the moment you mention the word police patrol, you automatically make certain assumptions of where the police is going to be. And in those neighborhoods, are the police thought of as protectors, as people who are meant to keep you safe? Or are they thought of as invaders who are meant to cause you trouble? That changes depending on which neighborhood you're in. Look at the US, there's a lot of research on how you have what they call stop and search, where the police can stop you and search you if they think that in your car you might be carrying heroin or drugs. And there's a clear link between a black driver being stopped and searched, which happens far more than a white driver. So that also happens. The third, of course, is the suspect's photograph. Right? And when does the police feel entitled to just take a photograph of an individual without their consent and upload that? Presumably, again, in Church Street, if you're walking down the street, they would be a little more hesitant before just taking a photograph and uploading that. A kind of hesitation that may not be that apparent in other neighborhoods. And of course, the last is crime history. And if you look at the statistics, and we'll come back to this later on, you will find that the prison population in India has a disproportionate representation of Dalits and Muslims. So the relevant correlation between the population that the Indian population has of Dalits and Muslims vis-a-vis the number of them in prison is very disproportionate. There's a far greater number of them in prison than actually in the population. And of course, a simple answer to that is that it could be because they commit more crimes, but if you go a little deeper, you will find that a lot of biases operate in the criminal justice system that result in this kind of a ratio. You see it a lot in the recent protests in UP, where the police themselves have admitted now that they have taken a whole bunch of people from Muslim neighborhoods that weren't involved in protests, so they just picked them up randomly. And these kinds of figures then inflate the prison population of these communities. So the moment you're uploading some of that photograph and checking against the crime history, you should know that the data that already came in and made that crime history itself is not free from all kinds of biases. And so you see how this seemingly straightforward statement of taking a photograph and uploading it into a crime history at 2 in the night on a road where somebody is walking and looking suspicious carries within it implicitly a whole host of assumptions, biases, that can perpetuate already existing kinds of marginalization and vulnerabilities that exist in society along various fault lines. And but once you have this app that does this, it's out of your control, right? The police will use it, and they will use it in the ways that they deem fit. And so in the very design of the app, you have given the possibility of these kinds of uses, which will then be magnified in the actual use. And if you want more examples of this, very vivid and concrete examples, there's a great book called Automating Inequality by Virginia Eubanks. And she takes the examples in the US of the housing market, for instance, of the decision of custody of children, and so on. And she shows how it's not that tech is itself creating problems, but you have, if you have existing fault lines in society, then the use of tech can magnify those fault lines, or it can mitigate them. And that's where the key question arises. Now, I want to link back briefly the statement that the CEO of FaceTiger made with the Constitution, because I've talked about the problems that it creates. But what does the Constitution have to say about it? And let's begin with the idea of equality, because that's really at the heart of a lot of the debates around the interface between tech and the Constitution. Now, for a long time, we used to operate with a very narrow understanding of equality. The idea was that unequal treatment can only take place if there is an agent, a specific individual, who is doing that unequal treatment, and that agent has to be guided by malice, by bad motives, by bad reasons. So right, okay, if a policeman deliberately and intentionally stops a person on the street because they are black, right, and searches them, that's discrimination, that's unequal treatment. But for that, you have to have a specific person, the policeman doing that, and you have to show that the reason why he did that was because he's a racist, he doesn't like black people, because he's motivated by you know, ill intent towards that race. That was the definition of equality in our understanding what unequal treatment means. Of course, a very narrow understanding. Over the last couple of decades in the Indian constitutional context, over the last few years, in cases like the 377 case, which you all know about, and the privacy judgment, which also I'm sure you all know about, there's been a much more nuanced and evolved understanding of what equality means. And this is an understanding that no longer looks at inequality as being the result of individual choices to discriminate, individual malicious motives, individual racism, but as a function of design. Of design that goes into how our institutions operate and how our social structures operate. So this kind of an approach looks at not the reasons or the motivations underlying actions, but at the results or the effects of those actions. So if you find, for example, that in a workplace, the proportion of men to women far outnumbers the proportion in the larger population, that should give you an indication that something is wrong. Right? You may, after detailed research, find that the reasons underlying that have nothing to do with gender disparity, but more often than not, you will find that actually they do. So for instance, if a particular workplace does not have a pregnancy leave policy in place, then it will discourage a number of women from applying for the job in the first place, and then that will result in a skewed workforce. This is a very basic and simple example, but of course, inequality can have many more nuances that are not as basic as this. So this understanding of inequality takes into account, first of all, a long history where there was a prior history of intentional discrimination, which has now been done away with, but whose effects still persist. The philosopher Bernard Williams had a very interesting example where he talked about how imagine a society in which only a certain class of people can become soldiers. There's informally in law, you have that discrimination written into the law. Now, at some point, you remove that. And so now, formally, it's all equal. Anyone can apply for the army. But you also find that over the years, because the army is revered in the society, those who were in the army, people of a certain class, had access to the best kind of healthcare, the best kind of access to the most nutritious diets, all of that. And so now you have a seemingly formally equal test, but you also find that only those people who are already in the army are now in the position to make use of the neutral criteria you have put in place, say a physical test and so on. And so obviously you have to go beyond just neutrality and ask yourselves, what is the underlying reason for the effect being unequal? So look at the historical reasons, look at how institutions work, unquestioned norms, unquestioned biases, and look at the effects. And then in that sense, you get a much broader idea of what equality means and requires. And so when you come back to the face tagger example, what you find is that under the old and narrow view of inequality, you wouldn't find anything wrong with this, but because, okay, you have built this app. The point of the app is actually to ensure law and order. So the police will use it to try and check suspicious people moving around. And so there's nothing in the app itself that is biased. But okay, maybe the odd policeman, you know, has a prejudice against Muslims or against, you know, people of a certain class. But you can always deal with that by training him or giving him or her, you know, lessons. Whereas this broader idea of equality goes much beyond that and looks at the systemic presumptions and biases that underlie the police force, the criminal justice system, and asks how that links to what the app is doing. And so of course, if you ask those questions at the beginning, when you're thinking about what this app will do, what your goals are, what your purposes are, then you may end up designing something different. What you would do, obviously, I can't tell because that's not my area of expertise. But if those ideas are in your mind when you're starting off, as opposed to at the end of the process, then you may find that the design is something else that takes into account all these variables. You're still talking about, in the police example, you're still talking about, you know, a more conscious bias in the police force. But it might be even more, you know, subtle and even more nuanced. So one thing that's on the radar right now is the DNA bill, which talks about DNA data banks and, you know, having a data bank of criminal suspects. So what this the proposed law does, for example, is that it says that if you're convicted of an offense, then your data will be stored permanently in the data server and in the DNA data bank. And if you're, if there's a trial going on, then there's something more. But even if you're a suspect of a crime, right, still the police can take your DNA and put it in the data bank. Now again, coming back to the whole idea of how the criminal justice system substantially overrepresents certain sections of the population in prison, even as under trials without being convicted, you'll then find by extension that the data bank will then have a disproportionate number of people belonging to those communities whose privacy will be violated, who will be subject to the possibility of false matches in the data bank and so on. So in the US, they actually found that because the DNA data banks disproportionately had the DNA of certain communities, the risks of false positives and therefore of false convictions exponentially rose for those communities. And so again, you may think you're working on a DNA data bank, but if you see the chain of causation, you will find that it leads to consequences that you wouldn't even imagine when you're working on the bank itself, because those aren't necessarily in your mind, because what you're working on is just making that data bank as good as it can be. And so I think that at the very beginning of the process, thinking about these constitutional values and principles and how they would impact the project at all its stages would go a long way towards thinking about issues of design. Often these would require having difficult conversations with people that are not always immediately within your immediate, you know, context. So I remember that at the whole time of the Aadhaar debate, there's a person called Bezwara Wilson, some of you might know him. He runs this organization called the Safai Karamchari Andolan. And for the last 30 years, he has been involved in the fight against manual scavenging. So as you know, in throughout India, we still have this practice, technically outlawed, but it's still very much there. And he has been fighting for the rights of people who are forced into manual scavenging for many years. Now, he was one of the strongest opponents of Aadhaar, and his reasons were reasons that I, coming from a very different background, couldn't understand fully back then, and I still don't understand completely myself. So he said, and he wrote an article, and it's online, and you can read it. So he said, he was talking about how certain schemes that were specifically targeted at the community of manual scavengers required mandatory production of Aadhaar in order to avail of those benefits. And he said that this whole process is essentially fixing us in a particular identity as manual scavengers. And all our lives we've been trying to escape that, to move beyond that. And now this mandatory production of Aadhaar to get those schemes essentially locks us into that identity, makes us, you know, thinks of us as being fixed there in that position. And we want to, you know, go out of that. So we don't want this whole idea of one nation, one identity that the government is pushing. We don't want that because identity for us is not a source of pride. And we are trying to leave that behind, and you aren't letting us do that. And I couldn't understand it back then fully, and as I said, I still can't quite figure out what that means in concrete terms. Maybe if I spoke more with him and listened more to him, I could understand more where he's coming from. But clearly you're talking about a person here who's really been in that field for many, many years, and who has an objection to this particular piece of tech that is requires a lot of listening and understanding to even grasp for those of us who have never been in that position. A much more basic issue, of course, was that a person who is homeless, doesn't have a permanent address, had particular problems in getting an Aadhaar. Now, if at the time of designing it, the time of asking those questions, people who have never had to deal with what homelessness means, and there's no reason why you should be thinking about those issues, but there are real issues that then come up after it's all done and it's too late to, and then all you have are little fixes here and there, which actually again shows you that the issues of constitutional design are really important at all stages of thinking about these projects. And I think, again, Eubanks has the best statement on this, and I'll just quote from there. She says that when automated decision-making tools are not built to dismantle structural inequalities, their speed and scale intensifies them. And I'm just thinking back about something that Nilekani said way back, move fast and break things. Ultimately, you're not just breaking things, you're breaking people as well. And that's something I think which is very important to remember, because the point Eubanks is making is that what tech brings is speed and scale. And if you have those fault lines which I've talked about, the speed and the scale then tends to intensify them, unless you're thinking about how to actually undermine them and mitigate them. So what is, you know, to be done, and I'll close with that, with just an idea. In some countries and now among some scholars, they have developed what they call technological self-determination. It's a big series of words, but basically the idea is that at all points of time, individuals should have the right to decide for themselves how they will engage with a particular technological system or a piece of technology. They should have the power and the ability to decide on what terms they will bring that tech into their lives, and on what terms they will engage with it, and they may choose not to engage at all, and that's fine. They don't have to engage with it. Because again, I'm coming back to again something else that Nilekani said. He said once that if you don't have Aadhaar, then you will lose the right to have rights. And that's again a very telling statement, because the right to have rights comes from Hannah Arendt. And it comes from the idea that in any political community, you have citizens, and citizenship is marked by the fact that you are a person who has the right to access all those rights of equality, of free speech, and so on. On the other hand, if you're not a citizen, then you lose even the right to access those basic rights. And that fundamental distinction is what has been responsible for much of the oppression that we have seen over the last century. And so technological self-determination tries to bring that concept into play and tries to set out a very abstract and basic idea about the link between constitutional values and principles on the one hand and tech on the other. So I'll close with that and I guess open it up for discussion and questions. So it's open. Yeah, thanks.
So it would speak into the mic because we have 50 people watching online as well, and they can't hear you if you're not on the mic.
So I may like make some generalizations, and please stop me when I make them and close them. So since I come from a legal background and something which is far more closer to humanities, I see it differently from somebody who comes from a STEM background. And what I see as a generalization is that in STEM backgrounds, you are far more likely to rely on something which is to be seen as objective sources, and so you will fall into certain problems which I could most famously see with the kind of controversies with the book The Bell Curve, where you make generalizations on race and IQ by saying that people of certain racial backgrounds are far more likely to have lower IQs and lower economics and all of that. And so it becomes very difficult for me to understand how any sort of differences can be made, or when anything in the STEM field or even technology specifically can be used to ensure that like greater accessibility to people from disparate communities can be there, or you don't oppress people far more. Because STEM in general, I see, relies far more on modernity as a philosophical approach and neoliberalism and capitalism as an economic approach. And so it's very difficult for you to like, you know, validly show reasons for Dalit studies or grievance studies, as they call it, people who oppose it, right? Yeah. Anything of women's studies, Dalit studies or black studies as seen as grievance studies, which are unscientific and therefore cannot be relied upon for building any sort of anything which is commercial in nature, which can be used to like, you know, make profit.
So I think that I think you're right in that there is a certain discourse that there is a kind of objectivity which is not colored by political bias that, you know, exists in STEM that you know gives its judgments a certain legitimacy that, and they can't be challenged on you know on these grounds. So I'd say two things. I'd say one is that I'd recommend, and I'm sure you've read Thomas Kuhn's Structure of Scientific Revolutions, where he goes into the whole history of science. And he actually shows how what we think of as scientific objectivity is actually not all that objective. And at any given time in history, there are certain paradigms which provide the horizons to how we can think and what questions can be asked and how they can be answered. And it's these paradigms that then structure within them these ideas of objectivity and knowledge divorced from political or moral bias. So I think that book is really helpful in I think just clarifying that objectivity might not be all that we think it to be. I think secondly and more importantly, to bracket some of the issues that you've raised in your question, and to say okay, these are things that require discussion. I think one point to stress is that the interface between these tech models and constitutional rights, I think you can actually, as something as I've shown, if you actually show, for example, that the criminal justice system, right, in prisons as under trials, the disproportionate representation of Dalits and Muslims, and that you can't trace that back to ideas that there are, you know, inherently more prone to crime, and so that the only answer is that there is a systemic bias in the criminal justice system against these communities. You are using the very tools of reasoning from evidence that are valued in STEM. So I think that there can be a conversation between people building tech systems and constitutional thinkers that can use the same framework of thinking and have a discussion within that same framework. Now, of course, I agree with you that there is a sometimes we need to go beyond that, But I think we can start with the discussion within that framework, and then after a while maybe think of moving on beyond that and debating the very idea of objectivity itself. But we don't need to start with that foundational debate, I think. I'm up to the moderator.
So I'll start with probably saying that laws provide a sort of framework for organizations, especially private organizations, who probably a lot of them are technologists. So to go back to your point on maternity benefits, I mean, for a corporate, the fact that there is a Maternity Benefit Act will preclude the possibility of organizations possibly not giving employees maternity benefits. But that does not exist in tech today. So in the absence of legal frameworks of removing bias, transparency, explainability in systems, what can organizations and companies actually do to have more, and also to take into account that we are all human beings with our unconscious biases, and we know of the narrative of the tech bro culture, which in itself has multiple blind spots. So what can companies actually do to sort of work on this and create a more valuable system which actually presents, you know, that there could be biases in training data sets and so on and so forth, and the checks and balances?
I think that there are many answers to the question, but I think that the most important for me is to have participation on equal terms with all the people who are affected by those decisions. Right. So just to come back to this whole, I began with Project CyberSyn. Right. So one of the real revolutionary ideas in that project, which couldn't be implemented because there was a coup, was that in that control room, right, you wouldn't have Ayende sitting over there on his own. You'd actually have the workers from the factories coming in and sitting in that control room, and they are actually looking at the data and working out what it means. So I think that if you're looking at, for example, if the question is that why does this particular organization have a lack of representation of either, say, women or of people from a certain caste, right, Dalits, then the first thing to do is to ask them, right, what in these practices discourage you from applying or being here? And that's the starting point of any attempt to have practices that will then be more equitable. So I think that at least the opening has to be a conversation between the people who are framing the policies and those who are affected by it, and to ensure that those who are affected by it can articulate what they would frame the policies to be. And then, of course, you have a number of I think, in social science by now, you have a lot of literature that shows the ways in which hiring practices unconsciously, you know, discourage people. You have things as basic as if in any classroom you have like a seminar, then the person of the number of people asking questions are predominantly men, and that speaks to a certain kind of unspoken norm and so on, and how do you mitigate that? So I think there exists a large amount of literature by now that speaks to all of this. And also, of course, as I said, I think the most important thing is to start with the conversation. Yeah.
So you have been saying how the people need to be given more voice, right? Giving a chance to make their own decisions. But don't the recent events and also history by itself prove that people are not ready to take that decision on their own? Like time and time again, the people have supported or made way for dictators. Time and time again, the people have been involved and actively been brainwashed by various things and taken the wrong chance. Even in a democracy, taking a wrong vote, giving a wrong opinion. So that, if you give that much power to general public, to the general public who is actually not that woke, not that aware of everything, don't you think that will actually create more anarchy, actually, a complete anarchy or a complete, complete lack of democracy over time?
Right. No, I mean, so I think it's a very difficult question to answer, and I think that the historical record is quite patchy on that, so it's hard to generalize. And one thing I've read is that if you actually look at if you're going in countries that have had fascist regimes, and I mean outrightly fascist regimes, if you look at the level of support that comes for the fascist regime from the population, divided along class and income lines, you'll actually find that that amongst the working class, which you think is most amenable to that kind of rhetoric, given the economic difficulties they're facing, you actually find that the support is very less among that class, and much more among the classes that are above them in the income and economic spectrum. So I think which class of society is most amenable to going along with dictatorship is itself, I think, a fraught question that may often surprise us if you look a little more closely. But I think more specifically, so I don't think the argument really is that you have a situation where there is a pure rule of majority that, you know, without any constraints. The point of I think a constitution is that it creates a structure within which that conversation can happen on equal terms, right? So rights like the right to free speech, the right to non-discrimination, right? In India, for example, rights against untouchability, the rights against discrimination and access to private spaces, all of these are meant to provide certain ground rules that ensure that the people, when they come into being constitutional citizens, are coming into it within this framework of overall equality, of overall a certain kind of parity of you know, status and so on. And so it's within those constraints that the discussion happens. I think a very good source to read about this idea is Habermas. So in his book Between Facts and Norms, he talks about how civil rights, so the rights to free speech, to equality and so on, are what he calls co-equal with popular democracy. So we often think of these rights as being checks on democracy because, you know, they constrain what the people can do. But Habermas says actually, you know, it's the other way around, because if you want to have any meaningful democracy, then it needs to operate within these frameworks that ensure that nobody can be a tyrant, nobody can, you know, dominate. So, and so they move in tandem. So popular democracy moves along with these rights to together give you a model in which you try and insulate yourselves from the worst tendencies of tyranny and so on. It's an imperfect answer, but I think that it's the best answer we have right now.
Hi, time and again we have understood that the algorithms are biased and data monopolies like Facebook and Amazon base a lot of their businesses on these biased algorithms. But is there a legal remedy to ask them to disclose these algorithms for public scrutiny, because they claim, you know, IP rights and over it, and they don't want to disclose it and stuff.
Yeah. So there's been one strong argument for a right to the source code. So in many, I think the movements in many countries now saying that disclose the source code so we can audit for ourselves how this algorithm has, you know, been designed. And I think Srinivas has been somebody who's been arguing for that. But there's also been objections to that. So again, the general public obviously wouldn't understand. I would have no idea. Like, if you told me the source code, I would have no idea what it would mean. So again, you're basically excluding a large number of people from understanding how these algorithms affect their lives. One interesting remedy is something that in the EU they call the right to an explanation. So it is that in case an algorithm has taken a decision that affects you or negatively affects you, you have a right to an explanation of how that's happened, and by a human being. Right? So in that sense, you can't be affected without that happening. In the Aadhaar case, we tried to advance a similar kind of an argument, because one whole issue was that if in the ration shop your fingerprints don't match, then you don't get that ration, because, you know, according to the machine, you're not who you claim you're a fraudster. And so one thing we tried to argue was that if the POS machine shows that you are not who you claim to be because the fingerprints don't match, then you have to have a right to an audience before, like, a human being to explain to them that there is a mistake with the machine and not with you. And so the final call can't be the algorithms. Unfortunately, that didn't fly in court, and there's no discussion of that in the judgment. But there are strong movements to deal with the problem that you have identified in legal terms, and still very much an embryonic issue that's on its way.
So in one of your earlier responses, you did mention that one of the ways to ensure participation is for technologists to talk to constitutional whatever framers. In concrete terms, what does that really mean? Who is it that technologists should be talking to? And a related question is that the critique often from social sciences comes from the fact that technology and technologists don't necessarily recognize multiplicities and complexities on the ground.
Yeah.
From your own experience, what is it that you recommend in terms of awareness and education to technologists and to tech practitioners in terms of what is it that they need to, I mean, I don't know, books, I don't know what, but what would you recommend?
So I think that to answer the first question, I'll take a tangible example, right? Yesterday there was this, at APU, Azim Premji University, students are protesting against Wipro. The reason for that was that Wipro was involved in designing the tech for the NRC in Assam. Right? Now, the NRC in Assam has unleashed the kind of horrors that you read about in like books about Nazi Germany, right? You have detention camps, people killing themselves because they're off the list, people having to travel 500 kilometers in floods to show a document to like one government official to prove they are who they are, and camps that resemble concentration camps, right? So this is all happening over there. And you have people who are at the front lines, right? People who have seen for themselves what it means to live in a detention camp, right? People who have, lawyers who have been at the front lines trying to persuade a foreigner's tribunal that look, a spelling error in this person's name in two documents doesn't mean that they are not a foreigner. It means that it's just a mistake. And I think that if these people, right, are put into conversation with the designers of tech, it becomes, at least for me, very difficult to ignore someone telling you that, look, there is a detention camp in Assam, and in that detention camp, this is what happens, right? And so at least I would think it difficult to say, okay, like, we don't care, and, you know, it's that would mean something is, I mean, then we have problems that are larger than, like, you know, we need to, like, start from the basics. On the second issue of what to read, I guess that, again, prescribing reading lists is easy enough, and we can talk about that. But again, I think that the important issue is to generally be aware of the criticisms coming in. So again, my own experience is about Aadhaar, so I'll talk about that. I think right from the beginning of the project, there were a number of people who clearly were not out to disrupt it. There was no ill will. Someone like, for example, Jean Rez, right, who is a professor who has given up a very comfortable life abroad to teach in Ranchi, right? Like, it's not even a Jindal or Ashoka, he's teaching in Ranchi, right? And when he says that, look, rethink in the politest of terms, like rethink what you're doing and writes, explains why. I think that if it's hard, if you're aware of or if you're looking out for the critics, you'll find them, because they're there and they're speaking up. And then you have the platforms on which to engage with them. So I think, of course, reading lists are important. I think it's more important to engage as an evolving matter as things are happening, because then the conversation becomes about specifics. And the readings give you a framework, but I think it's much more important to talk as things are happening.
So my question is something with regard to why there was a justification from the state with regard to Aadhaar. Talking about e-governance and reduction of corruption. So I wanted to actually know, does corruption really reduce when you introduce Aadhaar, and in what space? So EPW ended up coming up with an article which is like a research article done by two individuals who were working with Aadhaar in Telangana, and talking about how implementation doesn't really take away middlemen but makes it easier for middlemen to go ahead and corrupt by various ways. So then I started thinking that is it ever possible that either e-governance or technology actually makes it easier for resources to be allocated? Has it ever happened anywhere? Or has it ever reduced corruption to the extent that governments can actually do anything? Or does it make it even more difficult for us to see corruption happening? Because for us, when we look at whether the amount has gone into someone's bank account through Aadhaar and whether they have withdrawn it, it looks like corruption's gone, right? Because it directly reaches them in the bank account. But the ground reality is that person still has to leave his working day, go to the bank, which is one bank far away, and that person can do whatever he wants in terms of giving you the money from the bank. So I wanted to know if you have had any study or known about any place wherein e-governance or technology has helped better resource allocation or reduce corruption?
You know, I think it's a very good question, and in fact, I with respect to Aadhaar, I remember that there was this story of in UP, there was a school in UP where they apparently found that there were 130 ghost teachers, and that Aadhaar had eliminated like ghosts, because they didn't exist. It was all, they actually existed. It just happened that their fingerprints hadn't matched, and so the system said they're all ghosts, and so you were overpaying all these teachers who don't exist, and now we have saved this much money by not, and that would become a savings, right? And so you get all these examples which came out at the time. I think that at least from my own work, and I should obviously clarify that as a lawyer who was opposing Aadhaar, I'm obviously biased, so you can take what I'm saying with the few tons of salt. It seemed to me that the evidence on the reduction of corruption was very sketchy, and at many times it didn't seem to add up. And people like Ritika Khera have written extensively on the different kinds of things that happen at the level of the POS, of the distribution, and how Aadhaar can only take care of one of them, and even that. There are all these studies, right? On your issue of whether tech can enable, I mean, the answer is obviously yes. Examples, I can't think of examples off the cuff, but I'm sure like they exist. But even in this whole debate, I think the debate was never about not using tech, right? The debate was about using tech in a way that empowers people and doesn't disempower them by forcing them to go to the POS machine and put their fingerprints in at the risk of not getting rationed. So that is the problem. It's not that the tech is being used. In fact, I think that at many points there were various solutions, for example, smart cards in which the biometric details are stored on the smart card so that you don't lose your, it's not a centralized state database that's like keeping them, but you have control over them. So those kinds of options where tech is used to enable and not to disable were often discussed and were on the cards. I think for more on that, you'd have to ask somebody who's more familiar with this history, because I'm not that familiar with it. Sorry. Yeah.
So in this question of, does tech solve problems, I think as technologists, we tend to forget one very fundamental thing about technology. Technology is a tool that empowers whoever you give it to. So it amplifies your intent. Like if I want to commute and I have to go from here to somewhere 2 kilometers away, I can walk on my own feet. But if you give me a car, I'll move faster. Okay. So, but ultimately, the tool has empowered me to do what I intended to do. So it doesn't empower me to do something else. I mean, it doesn't empower someone else. It empowers the person you give the tool to. So one of the things that's commonly mistaken about implementations like Aadhaar is who are you empowering in the first place? It's an empowerment tool, yes, but who is it empowering? And that is something that is often not considered in the discussions about technology. So for instance, if you empower the state or the machinery of the state, and you're also complaining that the machinery of the state is corrupt and not benefiting an individual, then how does empowering them help the individual? It just empowers them to do more of what they're trying to do. Okay? And so that is something that you have to bring into any discussion when you talk about whether technology can solve the problem or not.
Just a second, passports. So when passport offices 15 years back, it was run rampantly by corrupted people. You had to give extra money and you would get your passport within 5-6 days even. And now, because it has the technology and Tata has taken it up, or TCS as far as I know, it is centralized, there's a database, they cannot do anything to you, they cannot do any favors to you, they cannot take money from you. So yes, corruption has reduced due to technology, because at least in my experience, in that particular field.
Hello. Yeah, don't need to stand up. Mine is a little bit of a personal question, I guess. I've always been of the opinion that people should be completely free to say whatever they want to see. Like, I think a lot of us in this room would probably be along those lines. But I've also seen what unfettered free speech usually leads to. So I don't know how many of you are on Reddit, but there was the issue that certain groups of people, like when the whole Donald Trump thing was happening, there was a
When the whole what?
Donald Trump election was happening in the US. The Donald subreddit, there were allegations that there was like hate speech and brigading and that kind of stuff. And a lot of people moved away from Reddit to another platform called Vot, V-O-A-T, which turned into kind of this hotbed of extremist ideologies. I mean, basically far-right kind of philosophies and stuff like that. So even though I believe that everyone should be able to speak freely, like he said, technology enables people to do things, and when there are a lot of loud people coming together and kind of snowballing into a bigger force, it can lead, it can have very unpredictable consequences, which I don't think, maybe I'm wrong, the legal system has yet seen. Mathematically, these are kind of new models of behavior of you know, how people are interacting.
Yeah.
So, I forgot my question. I think I have. So my question is, personally, and okay, maybe from a constitutional standpoint, do you think there is a very clear line or a clear guideline by which you can kind of, if you are creating a product or if you are trying to, you know, define your own personal morals or boundaries or stands or whatever, do you think there is a line that clearly demarcates censorship and, I don't know, what you would call it, preventative?
The answer is no. I don't think there is a clear line. It's a very, very difficult call to make, and the reason for that is that even if you were able to define what constitutes hate speech, what constitutes speech that we all agree should be beyond the pale, language is a slippery instrument. So I'll give you an example. There was a famous case in Europe. It was in Belgrade. Yeah. So in Belgrade, they had put up a red star outside a house. One person. So it was they basically wanted to prosecute that person because they said that the red star signifies Stalinism. It was Stalin's symbol, and Stalin's crimes obviously are so great. He's massacred so many people that it is equivalent to hate speech, right? It's a bit like Holocaust denial in Germany, right? The scale, in fact, he killed more people, right? So the scale is that much. So they said, look, this is hate speech, so take it down. Now, when it went to court, this guy says that, look, the Red Star is not only Stalinism, it also is a workers' unity symbol. So how can you ascribe to it this one meaning that it's Stalinist, right, when it is reasonably possible to have at least two meanings to it? And the court says, well, and that's right. I mean, if it was like a burning cross, a clan symbol, right? There are certain things that are like that the German swastika, any of those things, right? There's a unique meaning there which you can't get over. So then, yes, that's there. But there are so many things that are open to more than one meaning. It becomes very difficult then to affix a single meaning to them and say, okay, this is the meaning that is beyond the pale. So I think that the clear line fails simply by virtue of the limits of language. In principle, should there be like a limit? I think that yes, there should be. And that's because words are not just words. Words are always embedded in a larger context, a larger social context. So, which is why in some of the more evolved constitutional democracies, it's not treated as a question of free speech, but a question of equality. So in South Africa, for example, their hate speech law comes under the Equality Act. And that comes from the experience with apartheid. So the idea is that in an apartheid state, a whites only sign on a restaurant is not just those words, but it's an integral part of that entire system of apartheid that subordinates one group to another. Right? I think the best exposition of this, and I hate to recommend the judgment, but it's a very, very clear, judgment, is a Canadian Supreme Court case called Saskatchewan versus Watcott, where it really spells out why hate speech is a problem and why we are trying to deal with it. Now, the second issue there is that the people often assume that once we agree that certain kinds of speech should be, you know, beyond the pale, criminalizing it is the next step. Right? But that is not at all necessary. So, for example, in the US, Catherine McKinnon and Andrea Dworkin, the two feminist scholars, devised a law that was supposed to deal with violent pornography and pornography that specifically subordinated like women to men, and their solution was not a crime but a civil offense which requires you to pay compensation, because the idea was that the problem here is that you are causing harm to women by normalizing certain kinds of behavior. So the response is to compensate for that, right? And so you can have a range of remedies that are not censorship but deal with our intuition that certain kinds of speech is problematic, right? So I think that's the answer there, and I have personally, I mean, I haven't done much more research on this, but I've been hearing of late that certain models that deal with self-moderation of communities are the way to go forward. Something like what Mastodon does, it seems to be working recently. I don't know enough there, but it's something I find something intuitively attractive is the kind of self-policing, self-moderating communities that come together and decide, okay, our values are A or B, and this is what goes beyond our values.
Hi. So we saw a question from that side about helping people represent, to which the answer was participation, and this question about snowballing when there's a majority. So I want to ask your views on the amalgamation of two, which is when you give proper representation to minorities, still in a room of say 10, 15, 20 people, yeah, there'll be one person representing that.
Yeah.
And even if you go by a democratic system, if other 11 people agree out of 20, there's nothing that one individual can do which will still lead to whatever issues the minority or that sect is facing.
Yeah, yeah.
So is, in your view, is there a good way forward to address this kind of a problem?
Yeah. Technically, there are many design issues you can bring to address that. So one is you have veto points, for example. So you can have a system where if that issue affects that group or that individual, then they have a veto over it. You can have a much lower threshold. You can have, for example, the requirement that two-thirds majority, there must be a two-thirds majority for any kind of change that affects those kinds of issues. In the Indian Constitution, you have a requirement that if you want to amend the Constitution that affects a state interest, then 50% of the states must agree to that. So I think that you can depending on how much weight and what kind of weight you want to give to these issues, on the one end of the spectrum, you can have a simple requirement of participation and consultation, but then majority wins or whatever. At the other end, you have a veto, a straight off veto. In the middle, you have a range of options that can deal with it depending on what you think. You can have a requirement that you can have a first veto and then second time it has to be done. So there are many, many models that you can look at depending on what you think is the correct balance between these points. So I think that, again, I would say the most important thing is to ensure that in the beginning, when the conversation begins, it's in a framework of overall equality. So it's not that the minorities are coming as supplicants, as people who are trying to persuade you of their view, but as people who have a view that must be given equal respect. And then you can move on and see how you want to design specifics of that model.
We have a question from Twitter. The question is that what is the law in India that guides free speech on social media? By keeping the post private to friends, is it really private? What is the law stand on this?
This is very interesting because there was a case that never went anywhere, but there was a case where members of a certain institution, basically on a private Facebook page, made certain comments against the management. And someone, as always happens, took a screenshot and sent that to the management, and then they got, they got suspended and the proceedings began. And so one big issue was that, was this private? If it was private, then can you take this action or not? And the answer is Indian law has no answer to that yet. So that is very much still a first principles case that you can argue on both sides. Broadly, what are the rules of free speech on social media? It's the same, the Indian Penal Code applies in the same fashion. So you can't have obscene speech, you can't have speech that creates hatred between classes. Unfortunately, sedition is still very much an offense, so speech is seditious. So all of that applies in the same way as it does offline. So I think, yeah, the question about private groups is a really interesting one, and I think so far there is no answer in law, but I think you will soon, I think, have a case that deals with it. But so far there's no law that will answer the question. Although, incidentally, on defamation, the moment you make defamatory speech to another person, then it's already, then it doesn't matter private, public, then it's deemed to be published, and then you can be subject to defamation proceedings.
There's only one mic, so it's yours.
Okay.
It's on. I want to ask a question from the technology camp. So I do research in computer vision, or something that at least could come under the broad aegis of computer vision. So, I mean, technology is not a monolith, right? I mean, it comes at various levels of abstraction and interaction. So, at one level, there's the product extreme. Aadhaar or FaceTagger is a case in point. It's technology which is as deployed in a specific application in a specific context. Yeah. And, you know, that's almost the easy case to take down. I mean, I've sat on panels on Aadhaar arguing that the design is really, really flawed at several levels, along with, you know, lawyers and sociologists and so on. But if you take a step back, I mean, you know, take FaceTagger as an example. At one level, you can critique the product for the horrible questions it poses about surveillance and bias and so on and so forth. But backing it is a more abstract field of machine learning. Backing that is a more abstract field of numerical optimization. So as people working in this area, how can we interrogate the work that we do through this constitutional lens that you talk about and then several other people have also talked about? Because we talked about these conversations that need to happen between scientists and technologists and constitutional scholars or people who are invested on the ground in sociological experiments. What do you do if you're not directly dealing with the product, but with these more abstract levels which do not directly necessarily lead to that obviously controversial product?
Yeah.
I mean, one obvious answer I can think of is just look at the breadth of applications and try to figure out which of those applications are directly controversial and which are not. Are there any other ways you would recommend looking at this somewhat removed from the product work that we do?
Yeah, no, I think that's a wonderful question. I think that's the answer. One is, of course, the answer that you said. I think, first of all, I think it's important to say that this is a question that can only be answered by the people who are doing that work, because what the constitutionalists or the people like Beswara Wilson, they can put forward what their concerns are. But at that level of abstraction, right, there's no way that he or I can possibly gauge, you know, what this process is or what that will lead to. So that is something that we are completely locked out of, because it's a highly specialized process that has its own vocabulary, its own protocols. I'm actually reminded, my dad's a mathematician, and he's an abstract mathematician. And he recently found out, he didn't even know, that in Grenoble they were basically using his mathematics to do something regarding a brain to artificial limbs kind of connect. And he had no idea until they called him and showed it to him. Sometimes even the abstract scientists don't know what it can be used for. So I think one answer is yours. The second answer is something that I've read, I was reading recently, which is that it's a more kind of direct action kind of an answer. Which is that in Canada, in various universities, they had this movement where they basically wanted a complete severing of links between the Pentagon and the defense establishment and universities. So the idea was that if your funding comes from the defense industry, right, then like it or not, whatever you do, the direction your work takes will in some way be influenced by the demands of that industry, right? And so even though in the beginning you can't see that link, ultimately you will be making products that will have some use for them, and that will happen in various insidious ways. So if you cut off that at the source, right, and make sure that your university does not, or that department in which you are, does not have funding from the Pentagon, right, then you are ruling out one possible source of thing at the beginning, and in many departments they did agree to divest from that. So that's one possible solution. It's a very hard one, because money is hard to come by, and of course, but that's one thing. Yeah.
Because I'm an artist, I don't understand legal frameworks and how it works, but I was thinking the way you framed things about technology, it feels like it's kind of final from the beginning, as if there is an intent, and that intent can be achieved, but often technology is always in the process of becoming. Yeah. It's not really finished.
Yeah.
And I was thinking of that defamation case against Heard Scene, which also goes to the Twitter question.
Sorry, defamation case against?
Heard seen this.
Heard and seen, huh? Okay. Yeah, and
I was wondering what are the legal frameworks that also kind of interacts with technology, not as a finished product.
I think I completely agree. So, which is why I think I tried to say in the beginning that awareness of the constitution and the constitutional values has to pervade the whole process. So it's not something that you look at the end or even in the beginning, but at each step, just the awareness that this could have implications that go down that route. I think in the, you talk about that incident where the High Court asked Instagram and Facebook to reveal the identity so I think that's the interesting part, right? Because if you're a designer, right, you I think would be well aware that at some point the state will come and ask you for the details of the people on your platform. And so, again, I'm speaking as a novice. As a designer, is it possible for you to design a product where even if the state was to ask you, you would be unable to answer the question? And I remember a few years ago, I was abroad and there was someone, I think the designer of Cloudflare had come and was speaking. And so one thing he said was that our system is so secure that both Hamas and the IDF use it. So that's like how clueless we are about how to influence we have about the final thing. But he said that there was something called, I can't remember, something called a canary, which he said, which is that if like the state asks me as a designer for the keys to the system, then something will activate automatically, a message will be sent. So everyone will know that the state has asked me for details. And then they can take the steps that they want. And I'm really forgetting the details, but he had that model. So I think that you could, I think, easily predict that the kind of product you're designing would be of use to the state to do X, Y, Z. And then you can have from the very beginning certain design frameworks that would mitigate the compromises that you would then have to make later on, when the state comes calling. So that's possibly
here. So I'm a techie, and I kind of see law as code. It's often I see it as executed by people, not really by computers. But
so
I'm kind of.
Could you repeat that?
I see law as code.
Yeah.
Right. It's interpreted by people.
Yeah.
Not by computers.
Yeah.
But I can see parallels between you have these conditions and
yeah.
you kind of
yeah.
if this happens, this is what we've done, etc.
Yeah.
Okay. But now I'm kind of worried about the recent trend that the law is replaced by actual code and executed by machines.
Right.
And decisions are made by. The machines with no man in the middle.
Yeah, yeah.
So, I mean, Aadhaar is the one
example. Yeah.
OID replication that happened in Hyderabad and these places. Okay.
So
I want to kind of understand what's your views and what does constitution kind of, is there anything in constitution these kind of things from happen or what's the way forward?
Yeah, no, I mean, I think that's really a huge question. And again, so I have views, but again, I would say that I think the person who expresses this whole issue really well is Virginia Eubanks in her book, Automating Inequality. Like that book really, I think, speaks to the heart of your concern, and she has examples where she shows the exact ways in which code is replacing human decision makers in, you know, core fields of insurance, of the housing market, of child custody, and so on, and she kind of shows that. So I think that book I would recommend very strongly to just get a grasp of how the law interacts with all of this. I think, what does the Constitution say? Again, nothing directly, because the Constitution was framed at a time at which these problems were not even foreseen. And so it gives you certain principles and values that you try and apply. And I think what's more interesting is the concrete developments that you see around you. So as I said a little while before, this whole idea of a right to an explanation, the right that you will not be subjected to a decision that impacts you adversely simply by algorithmic processes, but you need to actually have the right to access a human being and be able to make your case before them, before the final decision is taken. So I think these are some of the modern legal frameworks that recognize the ubiquity of code in our lives and then try and see how the law could work to mitigate some of those influences that it has. Of course, nowadays, even lawyers themselves are being replaced by code. So in corporate law firms now, many of the tasks that lawyers used to perform are now being performed by algorithms. So I think even within the legal, law itself is being taken over by code apart from being like a code. So that's something to, I think, keep an eye on in the near future.
Okay.
Yeah, I wanted to make a couple of comments. You talked about the military applications, you know, and cutting off funding. But if you see in the US or in India, many of the things that the civilian population uses, the seeds of them were actually sowed in military, including the internet, right? So I feel personally that is a little dangerous line to take because the source of funding and the application may not be diverse. The other point, adding to what I think Kiran said, is often I feel that as a technologist, technology is often demonized. But what I think people should probably also look at is who is wielding that technology, right? A great example is like nuclear power, right? Nuclear energy can be used for like really, really good work, but you can also use it to make bombs. Similarly, when the internet came in, a lot of us who were the early users of the internet thought, wow, this is great, and you know, you can have access to all of the information. But now we have the problem of filter bubbles. So sometimes the first and the second order effects of technology is one not immediately apparent, and it's a little harder because in some sense, law actually has to do a catch up, and we are in technology pushing the frontier. So even to the technology, it's not very obvious, like, you know, what would happen. And the great examples of this in history, for example, a lot of the early internet, the reason we have like security problems is because there was a trusted network, but obviously that didn't scale. And then hence we have spam, hence we have break-ins and all kinds of stuff. One thing also I think missing in this discussion, which I kind of want to bring to the forefront, is that everyone has been talking about algorithms, right? But increasingly with machine learning and artificial intelligence applications, I think there has to be a lot of emphasis on the data that drives those decision making.
Yeah.
And unfortunately, a lot of the people are not talking about the data that drives.
You mean the input data?
The input data. Yeah. And I think that is something that you touched upon, but I think largely I feel that a lot of the people are just talking about algorithms, because algorithms may not be the only place where bias is. And also I feel that many cases, including Aadhaar, I think the even if, because we cannot estimate the first and second order of effects of technology, I think what would also be a good framework, and I think this is where I want your comment, is to have like effective maybe redressal mechanisms.
Yeah.
And I feel as technologists do not look at the redressal mechanism in case something goes wrong. So we don't have like the safety hatch, right? For example, if you see, and technology can build for that. A great example, I was reading a book called Endurance about this guy called Scott Kelly, who went into ISS recently. The number of primary and secondary fallback systems that you have for like re-entry into space or going into space, a lot of these can actually build, and that can, even those can be regulated. So the law can actually mandate that technology have some redressal mechanisms, and that is, I feel, something that has not been as a tool by law has not been effectively used. So maybe some comments on that would be useful.
Yeah, no, I mean, there are a lot of points there, and I agree with most of it. I mean, the funding issue, definitely, so it's always a complex decision. So it's never a clear-cut one. So it's always, I think, worth thinking about exactly where the funding is coming from and what military it is, what have they done off late, and things like that, and in what ways might your department's research be used for. So I think there are a number of issues there that would be at play. So on the point about on unpredictable second and third order results, I mean there's no denying that technologists can't see where it might go and knock on people and so on, right? So there's definitely a case to be made for taking into account that those consequences could not be seen yet and could be seen in the future. I think it's equally important to also say that here and now, there are people who are being affected, right? And there needs to be an equal amount of attention paid to the fact that in service of a possible future second or third order effect, what are you doing to people right now who are being made the subjects of this technology, right? And then that's where the issues of constitutional values come in. And to what extent are you willing to potentially sacrifice some of those values because you think that there might be in the future a certain kind of benefit? So I think that's a very complex decision to make, but it's important that both things be taken into account at all times. On redressal mechanisms, well, exactly, right? So that's exactly where issues like the right to an explanation, the right to not be subjected to a decision that disadvantages you purely on an algorithmic, you know, process. So all of those are redressal mechanisms, and the attempt there is to ensure that when things go wrong, the result is not something that is deeply damaging. Now, of course, the whole issue with Aadhaar was the redressal mechanisms in question, you know, were themselves had the same kinds of flaws that were there in the original design. So the thing is that okay, your ration, your fingerprint fails, so you don't get ration. So you have to talk to the guy, but the guy himself is the one who's denying you the ration, right? So then what kind of redressal is that? So I think that requires a little more thought. The redressal mechanism shouldn't suffer from the same kind of potential flaw that makes things go wrong in the first place. Right? That's what I would say. The issue of input data, I think, is a very important one, and it's regularly discussed in the literature around this. So the whole idea is, and so there's a famous term called automation bias, which is that because the algorithm itself cannot be biased like human beings can be biased, therefore there's no real issue of equality or discrimination when you have the algorithm coming in place of a human being. And that, of course, ignores the fact that the person putting the data in is a human being, and that human being has their own biases, and that will play into what the output is. And that's like a big issue. And in fact, a lot of the literature around the interface between AI and algorithms and constitutional, you know, values, like Vidushi Marda, whom some of you may know, has done a lot of work on that, discusses the whole issue of the problems with input data and how that can be dealt with. I think my last point is that, as you said, one should not be, of course, demonizing technology, and its value is immense and, of course, very, very important. And the second order point you said is also important. I think on some occasions, though, you can see at the time at which you are developing the tech how it will magnify fault lines, right? And FaceTiger is the best example. When you know that in our country the criminal justice system is systematically biased against Dalits and Muslims, and you're putting into the hands of the very people who are responsible for that bias a tool that will enable them to do it at a faster and more efficient scale, then you already know that's going to cause these issues. And so I think that the value of bringing in the Constitution into the discussion is that it helps you to understand that right at the beginning, what you're doing might lead to X, Y, or Z consequences. And that might then make you think about a design that will mitigate those consequences and might still allow you to keep your second order and third order consequences, you know, on the horizon if possible. Right? So that's what I would say to that.
Yeah, so currently they're using like facial recognition systems in India, especially during the CAA protests and all of that, right?
Yeah.
So two things. One is, according to me, they're doing it sans any parent law. Yeah. So how do you think they're going to justify this if it does go to court? And second, I mean, even if it does, like even if we do make a post facto law, has that been done before? Is that even permissible to make a law to accommodate to the scenarios that existed before the parent law existed?
Yeah, the quickest answer is Aadhaar, because Aadhaar was for 5 years, there was no law. Then they made a law, and they said that everything happened before is now deemed to be under this law. We said in court, look, this is absolute nonsense. I mean, you didn't have a law for 5 years. You're collecting all this data without any law. This is clearly unconstitutional. The court kind of hemmed and hawed and finally said that, okay, fair enough, you're right, there was no law. Our answer is that, okay, those people whose data was taken before the law came into being can now opt out. Of course, if you've already upheld Aadhaar for subsidies and tax, that is meaningless because nobody can really opt out now unless you're really bloody minded about being without Aadhaar. So that's what the court basically legitimized that. To answer the question more broadly, retrospective lawmaking is a pretty common feature of Indian lawmaking. In tax, it happens all the time. You make a tax law and you say applicable from 1960. That happens all the time, and so this could well happen here as well. I mean, right now there is no law. It's clearly beyond authority of law, and the data protection bill has been pending for a long time. But if you look at it carefully, you'll find that it gives wide leeway to the state to do all this. So even that may not really help. And of course, the issues with FaceTiger are well known, and we don't have to like go over them all over again.
Right. We're kind of running out of time. It's 4:40. We were going to just wrap up and have 15 minutes of coffee and discussion. It's up to you. You have another event to run to, we know. Do you want to take Q&A till 5 o'clock?
I can go on. Yeah.
You're all right? Okay, great. Also, just a quick note that there are T-shirts with the preamble of the Constitution. No? Sorry? Oh, sorry, Article 14 on them. And Gautam's book outside in case anybody wants to buy them after the event.
Hi, so my question is with respect to your response to the question on censorship. So you suggested self-regulation, right? But then the problem with tech is that it is empowering or increasing the concentration of power manifold with the people who are already privileged. Right. So what do you think, will it even work in that sphere?
Yeah, no, I mean that's really the heart of the issue, and I don't think I have an answer to that because the people who have access to the tech are themselves already, you know, people who have certain kind of privilege. There's in free speech theory there is this whole idea of the infrastructure of speech. And the idea that everybody should have an equal access to the infrastructure of speech. Up to a point, that made sense because you had newspapers and TV as being the primary infrastructure of speech. And so you could talk about equal time for political parties during elections, access, a right to a reply in a newspaper. There was a certain way you could argue that. But now I think it's very difficult to have a model which you can guarantee that kind of equal access. So I think that this is a problem that doesn't yet have a meaningful answer to give. So sorry about that.
Hi. I had two short questions. So taking from your bias in the criminal justice system, I wanted to understand how much weightage is given to the class factors of people who are disproportionately represented in the justice system.
Yeah. Yeah.
So does technology that is currently being used perpetuate this bias, or even a claim is made that we are reducing this bias through the use of technology? And secondly, when you talked about the PDP bill, so right now how we see Section 35, which is dealing with state surveillance and power, so the state has now made a provision which is resembling the restriction under Article 19(2) to the freedom of speech and expression. So I mean, what's the explanation that the state views data used by itself as a restriction on freedom of speech and expression? Yeah. So like, is there a link here that I'm completely missing?
Yeah, second answer I'll take first. The answer is no, because the state uses these words wherever it goes. I mean, it's become a template now.
Yeah.
And basically it insulates a legal challenge. The moment you take a legal challenge, the state will say that, okay, look, 19(2), same words, what's the problem, right? So that's basically the reason why they put those words now everywhere. It's a long history. So they began with it being in the Cinematograph Act for censoring films, in the IT Act, and so each time you'll have these words being repeated. So that's why that happens. On the first issue, So I think the issue is not so much that tech itself perpetuates this systematic bias in the criminal justice system, but tech empowers the implementers, like the police, as scale and speed, right? So that's what the issue is. And the class, so it's actually religion, class, and caste are all axes around which you see disproportionate representation in the criminal justice system. You see it in a project on the death penalty. It was found that if you are poor, you are much more likely to be, you know, given a death sentence than if you are not. And that also operates across the board. So I think that again, to come back to the point, it's that tech is not responsible. The fault lines which exist. The question is that tech allows for them to be magnified at a much greater intensity and scale.
So I had a question around an interesting question that was asked to a founder of a company called Andrew Industry.
Called what?
Andrew Industries. Right. So he used to, he was the original founder of Oculus Rift, and then he started another company that builds out surveillance technology for army bases. So they build tech that allows army to secure their bases. And the question was asked is, like, you know, today you're building a tech that is not, you know, aimed to be evil. There is a gray line, but you can argue that it, my tech is there to, you know, help out army secure that their bases. So another one is, so like, how do you, you know, go about questioning that? And that another one is, what is stopping them to, you know, repurpose that tech, the same tech that they sold off as a, as in key, hey, this is not evil,
yeah,
into evil tech, you know, like, what is the role of law in that? And the another question that I had was regarding tech-enabled propaganda and misinformation. So if we have seen it in Brexit, like, I'm not sure if you've seen the movie. There is a movie on Brexit where they talk about they did targeted advertising, yeah, to sway the polls. So again, like, if you give power to people, people will use tech to sway the votes,
yeah,
right? So basically tech-enabled propaganda, yeah. Cambridge Analytica, again, tech-enabled propaganda and misinformation, fake news tech-enabled, like, so like, what is the law's role in it, you know, how can we build or have laws around it?
Yeah, so on your first question, that I think, as we have discussed, I think even before, in a couple of Q&As, is that I think it, if you engage with, say, the history of what the army does, if you engage with what normally happens when a tool begins as a defensive tool, right, you will have enough evidence to know that what you're doing can and in all likelihood will be repurposed for something else. And in that case, you have to take responsibility then for that. It can't be an evasion of responsibility. You could still say, fine, I'm okay with it. But you have to then say, okay, you have to own it after that. Right? You have to say that, look, this consequence is something that is on me. That's the first thing. The second thing, I think, is that, yeah, so I think so far law has clearly failed to deal with this. And the normal legal responses of prosecuting people for fake news, you know, all of that, that's clearly not worked. Now, one argument, and again, I'm sure all of you will know this better than I will, so I'm just putting it out there. One argument I've seen of late comes from antitrust lawyers, and what they say is that a lot of this is enabled because of tech monopolies. So the reason why fake news on Facebook is so powerful is because for so many people, Facebook is the only source of news that they have. And so what they say is that the answer is to break up the tech giants and avoid tech monopolies. And I don't know if that'll work, and so I'm just putting it out there as something I've read from a legal point of view. Although I think it's very much still, I think Elizabeth Warren in her campaign has now promised to look into that, so we'll see if that goes anywhere.
Hi, so my question is a little more diffuse, because as the layperson, for me, design is a very diffuse term. Anything could be design.
Yeah.
And if you think about what's happening right now, where we talk about the citizens' responsibility to come on the streets and protest about what they think is constitutionally, or how constitution is being wronged at this point of time, or as a citizen, how you're being wronged. When you think about the entire system, it's so complicated and so complex that you don't understand where do you intervene and what is an individual's responsibility in order to understand these links. Because to make this more concrete, the example that I was thinking of was, we are living in a country wherein abortion laws are very clear. It says 20 weeks and after that it's illegal. Even then, it's very fuzzy. You don't know if it is actually legal. It says that no, only with consent of the doctor or with the approval. And here is where the technology comes in and says that for various diagnostic tests, there is a way that the state also, because it's trying to make sure that the issues with female infanticide are dealt with.
Yeah.
So it also says that a lot of information is not made available to the person who's directly concerned with. And I'm not even getting into women's rights and how the body is out of her control. But so when it is such a complex system wherein there is not I can't just look at the state and say you're being evil.
Yeah.
So there is a certain role that the design is playing in terms of how technology and diagnostic tests are being run,
yeah,
in order to say you have 70% chance of this going wrong,
yeah,
or 80% chance,
yeah,
of this going wrong.
Yeah.
So now do you have the option to exercise yes or no? But then the state comes in and says, but no, you have,
yeah,
gone past the deadline,
yeah,
so you can't do this. And over here again, there's class discrimination. You can,
yeah,
clearly see that women who are from upper classes get a better treatment, possibly, that, which has been documented in many of the court cases that we've seen. And recently, the government has come out and said, no, there is no unilateral decision that a woman can take.
Yeah.
So it's such a complex system. So as a citizen or as a lay person, where do I see my individual response to it? How do I understand the design of it? And I mean, I'm just curious as to what you would think about
it. I think that I'm going to have to give a very unsatisfactory answer to that, which is that all of us have a certain domain of expertise, and that's where we can see most clearly the fault lines and what the system is doing. So if you focus on that and get clarity on that as a start, and then everybody has their own areas of expertise, and then a conversation between different people can give you a sense of other points in the overall structure where there are issues, and then that will give you a holistic view. So and that's a very bad answer, but that's the best I think I can do on that. It just requires, I think, constant process of engaging with people who are not in your domain of expertise, because that will show you what other things are happening.
Hi. I have two different questions. The first one is along the lines of what we were just talking about for censorship, but it's more specific to lying.
Telling a lie.
We're beginning to see sort of Facebook now be in this position where they're impacting lies in the public domain. And Facebook says that we're not going to stop you from lying in a political ad. But you also mentioned defamation. So in India, you could be subject to defamation laws if you lied in a political ad.
Anywhere. Yeah.
So what is the sort of test that is used to determine whether you have made a political point and exaggerated a bit versus whether you have defamed someone? So that's one part of the question. And I actually have one more. And that goes back to free speech. And you sort of made your stand on this very clear about we should have limits. There's no such thing as fully free speech. So the question I have here is this. Why should the state have the right to regulate the bigotry in my head? The point I'm making there is essentially the thing that is bigotry is actually a shifting target. It's not one thing. What is bigotry today may not be bigotry tomorrow. So having one law that targets one specific type of bigotry is never going to be enough. You're always going to be subject to changes. So what is the underlying principle for that? So why does the state get to decide what I think or don't think? Which is a more fundamental sort of question.
Right. Yeah, I mean, so on your first question, there's a very interesting story. President Zuma of South Africa, he no longer president, he sanctioned some money to improve his presidential hope. That money somehow snowballed into an insane amount of money and ended up building a swimming pool and a kraal for his like domestic animals, and all kinds of stuff happened. There was a big scandal about this. Just before the election was going to happen, the Democratic Alliance, which was the principal opposition party in South Africa, sent an SMS to around 2 million voters saying that you know that Zuma has stolen your money to build his RAND 2.5 million home, vote DA, vote out corruption. Zuma is furious and he goes to the court and he says that this is a false statement. I didn't steal money. There was no theft. And so these guys have to retract it, apologize, and all of that thing which follows. The High Court says that, dismisses the claim and says that in election you can use words with somewhat looser sense, so it's fine. Court of Appeal says no, it's not fine, it was a lie. So the Constitutional Court splits 7-3, and some say yes, some say no. So you see, over three levels of the South African judiciary, nobody can agree on whether it was a lie or whether the word stole actually meant in metaphorical sense, like just doing something wrong with money and stealing in its broader sense, right? So again, I'll come back to the point that languages has so many limits that any attempt to pin it down as to what is a lie, what is political, is always going to be a very difficult task. And experience shows us that you will have a clear area. So if someone says that, I mean, so there was this meme that going around on Twitter that there's a photo of Yechuri from the emergency days reading out letter to Indira Gandhi saying that, look, resign. And it's now being turned into the opposite. So somebody is spreading it saying that he is asking her to forgive him for you know, protesting. So that's obviously a lie, right? Like, there's no dispute about that. So you have the clear cases, and that's why the law exists, to regulate those clear cases. But you have to also accept that there will be a large domain of very, very unclear cases, and that's just the way law and language work. So, and that's not, I mean, it's not a good or a bad thing, it's the reality, and you have to, you know, live with that. Secondly, bigotry. So I don't think it's about regulating the bigotry in your head. I think that, like, nor, well, A, they can't, and B, obviously they shouldn't either. So that's not it. It's more about the fact that when that bigotry or whatever it is takes the form of speech that is out in the world, then it's important to understand that it's not just words. And as I said earlier, speech is always part of a much broader pattern of conduct of social relations. So again, going back to the apartheid example, right? It's not that whites only sign, right? It's not just in the abstract. It's not a whites only sign that's a bad thing to say. That whites only sign cannot be separated from the entire social structure of whites subordinating blacks. So that's the very limited point that's made, which is that if you agree that speech is embedded in a whole host of non-speech patterns of behavior and conduct, and if you agree that equality is a value that we should all, you know, subscribe to, then there comes a point at which the two clash. Now, when that point comes is, of course, a very fraught question which we can disagree over. And who decides when the point comes? Well, again, your point is fair. Why should the state decide? But then who else will, right? In we agree that if we agree that the court in any state will decide when equality as a constitutional value has been breached, then we have to agree that then they will take that call. Of course, we may have a society where somebody else takes that call. But in our society right now, that's the body which takes that particular call. And it's imperfect, and it's often wrong, but that's, like, I mean, again, the kind of partial answer I can give to that answer. While acknowledging that what you're saying is very valid, and it's a very hard question to answer in a true sense, yeah.
Yeah. So I'm a technologist. I interact with various complex systems at various places of work. Now, earlier, till the 90s, right, like systems were designed as cars are. Like, they just amplified your intent. That sort of ceased to be true in the modern era when this individual interacting system started gaining their own biases, which comes back to the point of the ML and AI parts, right? Where a system develops an intrinsic bias that can be reinforced through outer stimuli, right? And when you compose a system of various interacting systems with their intrinsic biases, which are also subject to outside influences and that constantly changes these biases, these systems become very opaque and unobservable. This is what our current, like, the social system and the way we are modeling current systems interact and behave. So earlier, we technologists used to apply this theorem of reductionism. Like, somebody brought about objectivity, right? How did we come to that determinism that everything is an input, a process, an output? Because the systems were reductionist. We kept breaking the systems down till it did only one thing. For a given input, it only gave one single output. That has ceased to be the case. There was an interesting YouTube video and experience someone did. This pertains to self-driving cars, right? Where the decision made by the self-driving cars to whether in an ambiguous situation of hitting two different passers-by. One was a student, young in his 20s, in their 20s, and the other was an old person in their 80s, right? And a group of people were given the choice to democratically select this bias, like move a particular input towards whether you hit person A or person B. And how the system interacted and who the self-driving algorithm finally hit. Now, think about the ambiguity of moral choices a system can make in those scenarios. And now stack a plethora of multitude of such systems on top of each other, and what is the final output? The final output is not even what was intended to begin with, right? So no, the question comes to is that how can we determine, how can we make such technologies, like I am a technologist, I know, how can we in our hubris make such a system determine legality, like how, like the Philip K. Dick's book about pre-crime, right? Like, how can such an ambiguous system, which is so error-prone and biased, determine whether a person has done something wrong or right? Like, how can we give the responsibility to such a system, which we know as technologists can be so wrong, so error-prone and so biased? So, and why aren't we, like, directly sort of stopping that?
I mean, I think the answer is that you shouldn't, and predictive policing, the very idea has been shown to yeah. cause exactly these kinds of issues.
Like, this happened with Aadhaar too, right? Like,
yeah.
the error margin of fingerprints of facial recognition.
Yeah.
So, why are we incorporating already known flawed technologies into a system which relies on accuracy, right?
Yeah, no, I mean, that's exactly, I mean, the question, right? But I think that's for all of us to deal with together, and that's what technologists like to think of a little more deeply. So, yeah, but you're right, of course, so, yeah.
Right. So, we're nearly at the end of our time here. You're free to stick around and chat to each other and chat to Gautam as long as he is here. People might be able to follow him to his next event as well, which is, I think, in 10 minutes away on Mission Road. Is that right?
I have to check the map.
Yeah, it's very close by.
Oh, okay.
If it's open to the public, you could follow Gautam there. Otherwise, I think we're going to wrap up, but please feel free to stay on, have tea, coffee, and conversation. Kiran, do you want to just close? Oh, okay, there's one more question from the social media stream.
Yeah, so this is someone on YouTube asking you a question. You know, it says, one of the key ways that technology makes contact with society is through markets and market mechanisms. As the political philosopher Michael Sandel says, many of the problems we face today are because we are no longer market economies, but we're becoming market societies.
Yeah.
That we're making social decisions using market mechanisms.
Yeah.
So what are your thoughts on how markets mediate the relationship between tech and constitutional values?
Sandel's point is a great one. And the point he makes is that that the logic of the market is competition and atomism and isolation is creeping into non-market based relationships, you know, friendship and even beyond that. So I think the answer briefly is that I don't think there's a unique issue with on the interface between tech and, sorry, is it fine? Yeah, I don't think there's a unique problem to tech. There's a broader problem with the increasing marketization of society and how that is important to understand and to push back against. Tech again simply magnifies that fault line. So I don't think the answer is tech specific. There's a broader issue with thinking more about the extent to which we want market logic to penetrate into domains beyond the market. Thanks.
Okay, thanks.
Yeah, thank you.
I think
thank
we'll
so
end
much.
Over here.
Yeah.
So thanks to everyone who came. I think this has been an incredible turnout. I am pleasantly surprised by how much time we spent on Q&A. How many new questions we had. You know, it's not like you had one token question and then it's over. So I think that's been great. You've been a great audience. I'm also very surprised by how many people are watching this online. The online audience was competing with the live audience. There were about 50 people online, there are about 60 people here. So that's been great. Okay. So we have a bunch of these t-shirts. If you feel like wearing one, take them, they're free. If you want someone else to get one, please donate, but it's not required. And if you want Gautam's book, we ran to the bookshop and got some. You can buy one, get it signed. But because this is not the bookshop, there's nobody here to give you a receipt. So you'll have to come back for that or go to the bookshop for that. Thanks, everyone.